Welcome, everybody. Looks like most of you are all seated.
Yeah,
we're going to get going here in about 30 seconds. So the chef has told me that the food is ready. So we're going to start the program while the food is being delivered. And then we'll get on with the program in just right after we have a chance to have a little bit of breakfast. So, welcome again to the 22nd Annual Southern Arizona Attractions Alliance. So nice to see all of you. This is our first in-person meeting since February, when Rick Vaughn and Ed were with us and gave us a wonderful presentation on digital media. So we're so happy that Rick is here joining us and all the rest of you here. Tombstone probably wins the longest distance, so thank you very much, Tombstone, for coming. And we have really a special program today because we had our founder passed away, and Ed Harrow. And Ed is was a great friend, colonel of the 355th, just an all-around gentleman that you would want to work with. When he retired from the Air Force, he went over to Pima Air and Space as their executive director. He saw some things that he wanted to do to work with Visit Tucson. At that time, was the MTCDV. And we wanted to do something very, very special today to honor him with the Air Force Color Guard and also the singing of the national anthem. Now, Lady Gaga couldn't be with us today, but she was very kind to provide us one of her special performances that she did a couple of years ago. And if you saw her during the inauguration, you understand how special a rendition that she really can sing with the national anthem. So I'm going to ask all of you folks to stand up and sing along if you like.
Still there.
regarding Mr. Harrow, Colonel Harrow. Ed approached me about 23 or so years ago and asked if I would join him, Bob Edison, Pat Tierney from MTCVC, and Sherry Bang from the Tucson Museum of Art, and indicated that, you know, I just met you for the first time and you're at Old Tucson and I can't understand why we don't know each other. And I said, well, I don't know why either. I guess we're just working too hard. So he invited us to a meeting with Pat Tierney, and there was 15 of us there, 15 attractors. And it was really began the a wonderful partnership with 15 attractions as well as Pat Tierney. The Attractions Alliance started out at 15 members and now is over 120 members. So thank you all, because you're a big part of being the reason why we're here today celebrating our 22nd annual. Ed was a friend. He had a perfect seat at the Mountain Oyster Club, so it wasn't a bad place to go meet. I think every one of our board meetings for the first 2 years were developed over a few cocktails. So they were pretty lively meetings, and I think our marketing committee started joining us, so we had quite the showing and lots of engagement with our friends. Ed continued to work at Premier Air and Space for a total of 9 years, and then started another career working for his church, and then started a program working with youth in Africa. So very spiritual man, but had a military background. So we knew when to stand at attention, and we knew when to relax and just listen. Ed will be dearly missed by me and many others that are here. It was nice for the Air Force to do a flyover for us, even though it was on the video. And thank you very much for the Color Guard. This group that was here was the honor guard that was at his funeral back in December. So a very special moment for the airmen as well. So I like to remember Ed with his smile. He was, though, a pretty tough man. Flew B-52s and F-4s there in the Vietnam War. And then he felt, the heck with this, I'm going to start rescuing people. That's what I'm all about. So he taught himself how to fly a helicopter and was very much part of the rescue operations that's here based in DM. And after that, he, after winning the Silver and the Bronze Star and a few other wonderful military awards, he retired and after being base commander and went over to Premier Air and Space. And as I mentioned, that particular attraction, we're happy to announce today that they're back on board as a member of the SAAA and Titan Missile as well. So it's a kind of a special kind of day to have them actually back as members. So I would like you all to just enjoy your breakfast, and we'll get on with a short program afterwards. So enjoy.
Spin very well.
Okay. little surprised to see the news from Colorado.
So. Back, great memories.
Thank you.
She's a freshman, so this is her first. The first week she's been there in person, right? She started high school.
Different events at the club, the drug club. They have different things going on.
Remember, last year, right?
People with a week online.
Yeah. She's happy. Much more engaging.
Nobody was sitting there. There was one. Yeah, I think you brought that.
Okay. Karaoke.
Oh, fine.
No, because you're mandated to wait at least 15 minutes.
Where is that University Heights? Where is it located?
My daughter got a little upset. She went for her first shot.
Yeah.
Waited for 15 minutes. They're like, okay, you're good to go. Second shot, they made her rate 30.
It's good.
Well, and she didn't have a reaction the first time.
It's kind of nice for me because I grew up in Tucson. I went to the same high school. She's going to the same high school.
I got mine both times. I got it on Thursday.
22 locations throughout the whole
They've done fabulous.
Didn't really feel anything until Saturday.
Yeah. No question about it. Yeah, unbelievable.
And I just got tired.
So she's academia. She went to Northwestern.
My other daughter, she didn't have any side effects.
And she teaches 8th grade at a little local school up near the zoo in San Diego. It's called North Park.
Okay.
And it's called St. Patrick's. So she's there, and they thought enough about it. They made her vice principal, so she's great.
All right.
So that worked out good. And you'll find this of interest. They closed the school, as you know, probably in Coronado, just like your daughter. So she was very concerned with these things, so she took them up to her school and enrolled them, and they're thriving.
Good.
And they've been open ever since, they have a book. That's good. Yeah.
Well, that's great to hear. Frost is a. So we live not too far north of Norville Park.
Oh, do you? Okay, so you go to the one over there. Yeah. Oh, good.
Yeah, but then, Arizona did its.
Are you connected to Frost?
Weather thing, and
my son and his business partner are the owners.
Kaiser.
Yeah. Jeff.
So I know.
You know, Jeff and Robin Sue and Mike.
Yeah, so I know Mike from the U of A days.
And then Stephen is my son, and. Well, Jeff and Steve, they've known each other since the second grade.
I knew that your son was in Frost.
Yeah.
They've done
fabulous. Yeah, they're very blessed. Yeah.
Are they up in Phoenix yet? Or
yeah, they have three locations.
Wow, so they must be killing it.
Yeah, they have 22 worldwide.
So they're all franchised out and everything?
Well, some of them are their own stores. The three in Tucson, one in Phoenix.
Double glass store.
You ever been to Pearland? You ever been to Okay, they had a chance to go there. There's a wonderful guy in Phoenix that has a franchise in Gilbert and also at the Biltmore. And the advice of some wonderful people, they financed him as he was able to open their store. But they said, you guys don't want to have wine in the store. And, right from the same market. Said, you've been blessed enough to finance them and make it all for you. So they did, and then this crazy thing hit. And he says, I just can't sleep at night knowing I only have that money. So they took that back from him. And so that's kind of the story. That one, and then they have one they over
here. Some go this way.
Yeah, so that's one. Is
that number one, like, Abby or?
Yeah, where it is, Kevin is in Hawaii. We have two. And so what happened is, this wonderful entrepreneur that's really kind of known throughout the world, he was at La Paloma, having meetings. And he had to get somebody to the Apple store, so the limousine drove him out. And he sees this thing called Frost. they don't know anything about, you know, he didn't even bother going initially.
Right.
So as he was coming out of the Apple store, he came up into the escalator up there, and the car was delayed for 10 minutes.
And this time, like, on
stop walk in, so he walked in. He was rather intrigued. He liked the taste. And he liked they had a, we have a tomato chip in there. It's also a
spin.
Okay.
And in a franchise, we were asked
for it's like when you
get close, they didn't have all backup. So he made an offer, Rob and Kevin, and he bought the rights in the entire Middle East.
That's it.
So that was a blessing.
I just wanted to
find a mention again.
Okay. Thanks.
So I'm going to make a mention of that show. I've already got the beginning of my talk planned out.
Also, we have a number of seconds, 3 years.
Okay.
So
Department for so many years of support. I also want to thank the folks from Tombstone that are here. The folks from Tombstone always turn out. They're always the best dressed. And if you got a chance to visit with them a little bit after the meeting, I think you'll hear some really good stories. Now, is there somebody in the audience named Wyatt Earp?
Yes.
Wyatt is here.
Yep.
Come on up, Wyatt. Wyatt is going to share. Thank you.
Yeah.
Wyatt is going to share a couple of probably 5 or so minutes, 10 minutes. But he's going to share a little bit about what Tombstone is, and then he's going to probably tell you a story about why his name is Wyatt Earp, because it's a very interesting story. So Wyatt, the podium's yours.
Thank you, everybody. I have enjoyed a wonderful experience settling into my own Mayberry RFD. Now, I say that to younger people, and they have no idea what I'm talking about. This audience is my audience. Tombstone's become my Mayberry RFD. I have a home down there. I'm down there 4 to 5 days a week, and I have a house that I've had since 1968. I've been a place called Moon Valley in Phoenix.
Wow.
Over the years, I've had the blessing of touring two biodramas. One's called Wyatt Earp, A Life on the Frontier, in which people experience the man instead of the myth, which all documented to the penny. And the story Hollywood never told. The other is the gentleman Doc Holliday, and I had the good fortune to have the same dialect coach as Val Kilmer and Dennis Quaid, so we do him in accent and attitude. Wyatt was born July 19th, 1848. And I know what you're all thinking. I look pretty good for a 173-year-old man. At any rate, I know that Wyatt had the opportunity to laugh at himself and didn't. You never hear that. In 1925, in the Los Angeles Times, with the home and with the family there, his wife accosted him. He said, "Wyatt, it's not easy being married to a man who never says anything," because he was a very silent fellow. He looked over the top of his newspaper and said, "Well, Sadie, well, that's because I put you in charge of the words." Then he went back to reading his newspaper. True story. At that street fight near the OK Corral, where Virgil was maimed, and later on, as you all know, Morton was murdered, Wyatt later found himself at Iron Springs, confronted by 9 cowboys, and they all started shooting at him. Some of you know the history about that. But maybe you don't know what happened when he dismounted after returning fire. It had been a long ride, so I loosened his cartridge belt. And as he went astride, the belt fell down around his thighs, locking his legs together. So here he was, hopping around, trying to pull this belt up with one hand, when his saddle horn was shot off from under the other. He thought he was going to die, and just looked real silly doing it. Fortunately, his men did rally, and they were able to get away. So we don't see these characters with full personalities, but some of you may know that Wyatt was a great full personality and individual with a care for children and always wanted to have a family, though his wife about 30 years ago. And I had an experience I'm going to share with you real quick that I'll never forget. As I was coming up to the van after putting the set away, it was sloped with a sloped parking lot, and I heard a little voice behind me say, "I met Wyatt Earp." I looked around, I didn't see who it was at first because he was only 4'8" or so, and it was a sloped parking lot, so I was looking down on her head. This little lady came toward me, and she said, "Yes, I was working in an ice cream parlor in Vidal, California, on the Colorado River. I was 13 years old, and this old man came in mining clothes, all dusty, and worked for quite a while to get up on the stool, and he said, 'Hot Fudge Sunday, man.' I said, 'Well, would you like nuts with that, sir?' He said, 'No, it's just arthritis.'" True story. She really said this to me. And I later learned by talking to some people that at that time, she was 95 years old.
Wow.
So that's one of those little special treat memories you never forget. And I was telling someone over here that performing in the old Ryman Auditorium some years ago, a man came up to me and tugged my sleeve and said, "My son will be on the front row in a cowboy outfit, and he's celebrating his 10th birthday. 10th birthday. He said, "Would you come down and just say hi to him before you leave?" And I said, "Yes, sure." 10th birthday. I got down, children just are amazing. I got down there and I said to him, so tell me, how old are you? He tucked his thumbs into his belt. He puffed his chest up and he said, well, sir, I'm fixing to be 11. And I was about to tell my friend over there about, have you heard of Buckeye, Arizona, out west of Phoenix? I was performing for a school group there, doing a real short little bit. And when I finished, this little girl flung her arm in the air and waved her hand vigorously. And she said, Mr. And I says, what is it? And she says, I didn't know there were cannibals in Tombstone. Cannibals in Tombstone? What do you mean? True story. And she said, well, you said that town had a man for breakfast each day. Wouldn't touch it. I have been some of the most wonderful experiences I've had performing and telling people about the life just from those types of experiences and comments of the young. So thank you for having me and giving me a few minutes of your time. And if you want any more information, I'm sitting right back over there. I'll be happy to talk to you. Tom, I appreciate it. Thank you.
That was great.
As Wyatt said, a true story. And nothing but the truth, of course, for the rest of this program. We really have some special guests today, and before we get going with our program about the brand new Gem and Mineral Museum that's opening up, I wanted to just real quickly say a few words about the special guests that are here. And Wendy, you're going to come up here and help me out here.
That wasn't part of the plan.
Yes, sir.
That's my direct
cue. I only get to think I'm the boss. As I call your name, if you would please stand up. Rick Holland from Edited Mercury. Hi, Rick. Bob Logan, University of Arizona, and the Rotary Club. Kevin Bonine, University of Arizona Biosphere.
All right, Kevin.
Jack Camper. I think he's stuck. Oh, there he is.
There's Uncle Jackie.
I remember you from the Tucson Chamber of Commerce.
I remember me from there, too.
And Mr. Steve Ochoa.
All right, thank you.
And Tim, I'm sorry. I'm forgetting to say all the things I'm supposed to say about you wonderful people. Jack Camper was the Chamber President, recipient of the Knudsen Award, and an Extraordinary Mentor Award. Steve Ochoa, television media star, and recipient of the SAAA Founders Award. And Tim Bimmerstead, former Southern Arizona Attractions Alliance President, and the new Sales and Operations Director of Southern Arizona Alliance. And we would now like to introduce Bob Logan to give us a brief chat about the new Mineral Museum opening up in the old courthouse, don't you?
Okay. Great. Just a few words about Mr. Logan. He's what you call a plan B, but in my mind, he's always a plan A. Joaquin Ruiz was supposed to be joining us this morning. He has quite a bit of knowledge about what's going on at the Gem and Mineral Museum, and it really was an opportunity, for him to, when he retired, to really not retire. It's kind of like Bob and I. We're both retired, but we're really not retired. But Bob was very instrumental in the concepting and really the partnership development in order to get the Gem and Mineral Museum open. And it's going to be opening soon. So we've asked Bob to step in for Joaquin. I know, big shoes, I know, Bob. But since Bob has been intimately involved for over 30 years, 33 years, with the U of A, both as a coach and as in the athletic department, and then, of course, working for the science department, I got to know Bob when he asked me if I could buy a seat. And I go, what do you mean, buy a seat? He says, well, we want to put brand new seats in the Flannery Planetarium, and we need some partnership help. So needless to say, it didn't take very long. And if you ever go to the Flannery Museum, I'm L33. It's a good seat, actually, right in the middle of the action. So, Mr. Logan, would you please come up and share some thoughts? So I walked in about half an hour ago, found out I was going to do this, and let me give you a little bit of background. I went to South Point High School, and they're good. And my freshman football coach was Jerry Stitt. And if you've been around Tucson a long time, you know Jerry Stitt. He was an All-American outfielder at Arizona, became the head baseball coach after Jerry Kendall. He was my history teacher and freshman football coach, okay? And then as I became a senior, I thought it'd be really cool to try out for baseball. Now, I didn't play baseball since maybe fourth or fifth grade, but I was a pretty good athlete. And we were in the preseason training for baseball, and the only thing I did really, really well was when we did the piggyback races with our fellow teammates to get in shape. So I was not a hitter, I wasn't a catcher, and I clearly was not a pinch hitter. But today, I am a pinch hitter, and I went out to my car, and I have all my name tags in my armrest, so I pulled out my College of Science name tag to give this pinch hit talk. So here we go.
Push the button, Bob.
Where?
The enter button.
That?
There you go.
That is not me. And he would laugh if I said this, but you know, he oftentimes got pulled over it by TSA in the airport. You know, I think they thought Osama bin Laden was trying to go through the airport. So I can only say that when my former boss is not sitting here anymore. That is not me. Geotourism, we can talk about that in a second. So Tom is correct. I was married at the hip with Joaquin for about 10 years as we developed this concept of the Mineral Museum. Question for all of you. Who has been to Flandreau Planetarium? Okay, all right, put your hands down.
L33.
Who has been in the Mineral Museum in the basement of Flandreau? Okay, usually it's even less number of hands. So here's the background. We were in a budget crisis on campus. Flandreau Planetarium was part of the College of Science, and we were really making a decision on whether we were going to close down the facility because the tourism traffic was not there. Nothing had been done to Flandreau since John Schaefer built it in the 70s. Literally, the seats that we're talking about, they were the seats had tears in them. We did a tour with the Flandreau folks and the U of A administration to Flandreau, and we sat in those chairs and we had Flandreau play their movie. The movie that you would see in, you know, the Smithsonian or whatever. The movie that we were showing at Flandreau was something from the mid-60s. The clothes were, everything about it was dated. We came back to the office and Joaquin said to me, what do you think? What do you think we should do? I said, I think we should shut it down because nobody's gonna pay money to come to this going forward unless we make an investment in the facility. So to Tom's point, the planetarium, you know, where you have the star shows, we had a generous gift from the Lowe's Foundation. Linda Lowe's, many of you may know her, invested about $1 million to $1.5 million. And if you've not been in the planetarium, you should go now. All right, we're gonna get to the museum here in a second. The planetarium used to have a projector that was an analog projector where you'd stand and you could see the stars in the sky, and that's all. The new projector is a 3D image, so you can fly to Saturn and go through the rings of Saturn. So I know we're a tourism agency here, and so make sure you put Flandreau on your bucket list. It's a great place. Now, go downstairs to the Mineral Museum. Believe it or not, in the basement of the Mineral Museum, it was still one of the best mineral museums in the entire United States, even in the state of affairs that it was in. However, now that I know what I know about mineral displays, they were in wooden academic university cases with fluorescent lights. And the reason Eric Fritz, the director of the museum, is not here today is he's down at the museum right now working on lighting. And lighting is so important for display of minerals. And he showed me that you could put a mineral display here and put one source of light and the mineral is one color, and if you put a different type of light with a different wavelength, the mineral changes colors.
So the lighting is an important component of the Mineral Museum. So fast forward, we were about to close down Flandreau, and guess what happened in Pima County? They were losing the Pima County Courthouse. The assessor's office was moving out. I think, I don't know who the tenants were in the Pima County Courthouse, but they were vacating, and Chuck Huckleberry had this albatross on his hand, and we began to have a conversation. He said, would you like to take your Mineral Museum and bring it over to here? Well, is there a picture?
Yep.
Okay. So the Alfie Norville Gem and Mineral Museum is the new thing. We've been working on this for about 5 years, and it is a stunning, stunning facility. Who saw the article in the Arizona Daily Star about 2 weeks ago? All right, it is going to be something that is going to be really, it's going to inject some interest into the tourism community here. Flandreau in the basement was about 3,000 square feet. Flandreau Mineral Museum at the Pima County Courthouse is over 20,000 square feet.
Wow.
All right, so let me just give you some, it's about 95% populated. The shelves are pretty much all the way full. I'm going to give you some highlights that you might find interesting. When you come into the front door, we have donated one of the largest quartz specimens in the world. It is 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet tall. It is stunning. And that came from a gentleman that mines in Arkansas. Eric just told me that they have the three largest silver nuggets in the world. One of them is over 3 feet long. So you're going to see things that you've never seen at any other mineral museum around the country. One of the things that you often do when you go to a mineral museum is you look through the glass and you read little descriptions of what the specimens are. And we're going to have that, of course, but one of the things we wanted to do is to engage is there are many touch and feel stations. So there'll be a jade station where a big, huge boulder of jade, and you can actually engage with that specimen. Meteorites, you know, we have one of the largest meteorite collections in the world at the Lunar Planetary Lab, and we'll have meteorites on display. Malachite, the beautiful malachite from Bisbee's and Tombstone area, huge specimens where you can engage with. We've recreated a cavern from Bisbee, and you'll walk through the articulated wood beams into this cavern, and many of the stones that are in this recreation are actually specimens that have been pulled out of the ground in Bisbee, because we know mining is one of the biggest things about the state of Arizona. Let's see, let me go through the various halls. The first thing you'll see is you'll come into a place called Mineral Evolution. And again, this is a place that you'll never see at any other museum. Why? Because this is an academic-based museum. So we're gonna take the story of how minerals have changed from the Big Bang and the creation of the solar system to today. So you'll see how minerals have changed form and shape over hundreds and hundreds of thousands of years. Then you'll go into an Arizona-Mexico gallery, and you'll see some of these specimens that are so important to this region that you can't see anyplace else. We'll have a mining hall, and kudos to people like Caterpillar and Freeport-McMoRan and BHP Mining. They have all supported this endeavor. One of the really cool places will be the Gem Hall. And the Gem Hall will highlight the gem science degree that we are creating. We're going to create the first ever gemology degree program in the United States. So if you want to become a gemologist, you really get a certificate. From the University of Arizona, you will get a degree program and have a piece of paper that's much more valuable than the certificate you get in the trade. Okay, let me see here. I wrote some notes down. They'll also take some specimens like a diamond. What it looks like when you take this out of the ground, and then how is it manipulated to the final form of a diamond. We'll also take malachite and things, what it looks like coming out of the ground, and what it looks like in a piece of jewelry that has been made by an artisan. So you'll see the many other things that you would never see in a mineral museum. Now, the final thing about the courthouse, which is really cool, we are taking over the southern portion of the Pima County Courthouse. The west side of the courthouse, many of you may know, is the January 8th memorial from Gabby Giffords and that tragedy. And then the north side of the courthouse complex, it's in the, this kind of shape, is the Southern Arizona Heritage Center, I believe is the name. And it is a tourism traffic area where you can come into that space and learn about all the attractions in Southern Arizona. So a tourist might go, hey, I didn't know about what's going on in Tombstone. I didn't know what was going on with the rodeo that week. Let's stay a couple of extra days. And the multiplier effect of adding a couple of days as a tourist is going to have a huge economic impact on this community. So kudos to all of you, and also kudos to Hacienda del Sol. Tom mentioned I was part of Rotary. We've been meeting here for the entire year, believe it or not, socially distanced, four people at a table, very, very safe. And you know, you kind of get the feeling that we're coming out of this. And Hacienda del Sol has been a wonderful partner for the Rotary Club, and to be able to see everybody in person, it's been fantastic. So I'll stop there. If you have any questions, do you want questions or not?
Sure, there's time for one or two questions, if anybody would like to ask one.
What's opening soon?
Pardon me?
Opening soon, when is it?
So we are pretty close to ready right now. We were supposed to open at this gym show, and then COVID hit and everything got put on hold. We'll likely be doing guided tours in summer and the fall, not open to the public yet, but clearly our big grand opening is going to be next year at the gym show, and we'll probably have a soft opening in October or November. Yes, ma'am?
Yes, how does an entity such as Tombstone get something in that tourism center?
We actually have a very strict policy about what we put in the museum. And like most museums, there's probably only 20% that's on display. Everything else is downstairs in big racks. So you can submit something to Eric Fritz, our curator, and it will be evaluated by a committee, and you'll actually find out yes or no whether it makes the cut to be in there. Oh,
the tourism section.
I think that would be more on the Pima County. There you go, ma'am.
Hi, for the visitor center that on the south side,
yes.
You are represented. We have portals. We have a big map showing people where the location of things are. And Tombstone is a part of that. So it's discussed, and pretty much everything within Pima County has a representation there. We talk about water, we talk about culture, we talk about places to go and visit, and extend stay. So you're already there.
Yes. Can I
speak to
you a little
later? Sure.
Thank you, Diane. Don't go by. So about 3 years ago, the University of Arizona created an entity called UA Attractions, using the model of Pima County Attractions. So we sat down, John and Wendy and I, and we identified there's actually 22 things to do that folks from town or from out of town would enjoy seeing. Most of them are attached to the colleges at the U of A. So our newest member, I'm happy to say, is going to be, of course, the UA Arizona Alfie Norville Gem and Mineral Museum. Welcome to our family. And if you would please pass this on to that man that you did such a wonderful job representing. Thank you, Bob. One last thing to kind of add to the excitement without Joaquin being here, but hopefully he is watching on Facebook Live. Four or five years ago now, he started talking about that we all were at this wonderful place called Tucson, Arizona. No other place like it anywhere. If you go all the way up to Mount Lemmon, you come all the way down. It's just wonderful, really, from saguaro cactuses to all the wonderful things that go on top of Mount Lemmon. With the foliage up there, completely different than down here below on the Sonoran Desert. So he took a little bit of liberty, found an old National Geographic article where they started introducing this word called geotourism. He introduced it to visit Tucson, Rick, you were part of that. And next thing you know, we have this wonderful sense of place. And this is the reason why we live here, and this is the reason why people come here. And I can remember we were at the airport, and Rick Netter and Joaquin and myself and a few others were there, and all of a sudden, an announcer comes on at the airport and says, "Welcome to Tucson. Welcome to all the geotourists that are here in town. This, you'll get to discover a wonderful sense of place." And I think Joaquin turned 4 years old. He was jumping up and down and he was so excited because I tell you what, you know, it's like being on TV. When you hear your name, you get excited. And we haven't given up on geotourism. We all enjoy living here. It's just a wonderful sense of place. So thank you, Bob. You are excellent Plan B. Let Joaquin know that I'll always invite Bob to be his backup. All right, so on with really the excitement of the, so we can get you out of here and back to work. Wendy, you're up now. And Wendy's gonna talk a little bit about her year. And then she has a few things that she wants to share with a few folks. So, Wendy.
Thank you, Tom. Can I be Bob?
You can be Bob.
There you go. I'm short, sorry. I can wear heels. I would like to talk about some of the highlights from the previous year. Honestly, there weren't very many, unless you were accustomed to sitting at your dining room table with your laptop in front of your face. But we actually did have some highlights, and we had some unfortunate losses. First of all, I would like all of you to stand up, please. Give yourselves a round of applause for making it through the pandemic. I applaud all of you. It has been a rough year, but we're on our way back up, and that's nothing but a good thing. I'm glad it's back up. No, you have to stand through the whole thing. I just saw an article the other day of hotel rooms in Tucson were the highest they've been in a year this past month. And Tucson has had the fortunate has been fortunate enough to be able to continue most of the outdoor venues because we have such beautiful weather. Unfortunately, our beautiful weather kicked us inside instead of outside in the courtyard this morning, but you know, we'll take what we can get. So, like I said, it wasn't all bad. It wasn't all bad, and everything is looking up. So, while I didn't get to travel and see as many of the attractions as I would have liked to this past year, it seems like I was no sooner named president than I was locked down. I mean, I wasn't even going to work. I was working from home like everybody else was. So I do look forward now with everything opening back up to being able to get out and seeing a lot of you in person and shaking your hand and getting to know you better. I would also like to present the Southern Arizona Attractions Lions Star Awards for outstanding tourism leadership and helping the Southern Arizona Attractions Alliance. So first, I'd like to call up Jason Webb from Local IQ. Jason is an analytics genius and has been so helpful to the Alliance this past year, and I look forward to much more assistance in the coming year from Jason. So thank you, Jason. Okay, we actually have two other award winners, but they were unable to join us, so we'll make sure that they get theirs. And Jameson?
Go ahead. I know.
Oh, okay, so Matt Rowland and Katie Marquez, both from the SAAA, the Southern Arizona Alliance in Culture. And my board member, outgoing board member, Jalissa Gassman. I don't think from Visit Tucson. I don't think she made it in this morning.
Mary, could you come up?
Mary, would you? Can you accept for Jalissa?
I would love to.
Jalissa was our outreach coordinator and did a phenomenal job. And we are going to miss her. Excuse me. And if I could get the 2020 board members to please stand up. I know Chris, Hillary, Stan, Laura. Thank you all for your help and service. And I appreciate all your support and backup in doing a wonderful job in keeping this alliance going. And it is my honor now to bring back Tom for the presentation of the oath.
Congratulations to all the President's Star. We started this program about 5 years ago because there was really outstanding folks that helped the President. So the President at that time, I think she was from the Desert Museum, if I remember right. She indicated, what do I do? And I said, well, so we talked to our trophy guy, Don from Swarov Trophy, and he said, why don't we give the Star Award though? And so that's why we have the President's Stars Awards. It's my pleasure now to be able to talk about Rich Fedeli. Rich Fedeli was a founder in the sense of a charter member. He also was our treasurer. So nobody else was allowed to peek into the bank account until we had a board meeting. And at that time, we were all volunteers. And Richard, I can remember going over to his office at that time, was the International Wildlife Museum, and just ask him a simple question, has the International Wildlife Museum paid your dues? And he goes, hold on just a minute, let me see. And he, you know, looked through his files, and within 30 seconds, he says, yep, they paid it on March 21st. I said, man, this guy has quite the system. Well, he continued to be president, and then president for the second time. He is an extreme intelligent man. Unfortunately, his life ended due to cancer in 2014. I can remember him coming up to a meeting in his Jeep, and I always envied him because at first I wanted a motorcycle, and my wife said, no, you can't have that. And then she said, then I asked her if I could have a Jeep, and she said, no, you can't have that either. So I settled for a Mini. A little bit different there. But Rich was always at all the trade shows. Just an outstanding individual. So when he passed away, we created an award for outstanding excellence in leadership support to the attraction. So just a little history. Last year, Jane McCollum from Marshall Foundation, Chris's boss, also a charter member, one of our really first themed shopping areas, obviously associated with the University of Arizona. Wonderful lady, been there for almost the beginning, I think. And so we were very happy to honor her. So when you sit down and try to decide who is the folks that have helped you in a pandemic year, you know, you have to kind of look past the year. But there was one outstanding person who's been doing her job for many, many years. I know her from her golf days when the SAAA decided that they wanted to do to reach the volunteers with the passport. So this particular person said, sure, you can have visibility with the volunteers. And we said, yeah, we like to give them all passports for a job well done. So she opened the door, created a new program for us, and that was the first time that I met this recipient of the 2020 Richard Fidelity Award. So ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce to you the one of two Rich Fidelity Award winners, but who's going to come up first is Diane Frisch from Pima County. She left?
Yeah.
Well, good thing this is on Facebook Live. Well, ladies and gentlemen, Diane Frisch is extremely excited about being the recipient of the Fidelity Award. Can you go get her in the parking lot, will you, Catherine? Can you come up, Catherine, and accept the award for Diane Frisch? You know, it goes much better in rehearsal, you know, especially when you know she's sitting there. Congratulations, Catherine.
Don't give it to her. Put a sticky note over the table.
We have a marker.
Okay, well, this guy,
all
right, let me tell you about this guy. He's here, okay? I've known Kevin when the Biosphere became associated with the University of Arizona. And Biosphere is our number one most visited attraction next to Old Tucson. And, okay, Corral. Utilizing the Book of Fun. And Rick Netter, a dear friend of mine, and I have worked together on many marketing projects. So I met Kevin and really didn't get a chance to work with Kevin too much. You know, he had his academic world and I had my marketing world. He told the truth all the time and I embellished the truth a little bit. So Kevin, during the beginning stages of the pandemic when we all really panicked and we didn't know what to do, and all the attractions were closing. We had just ordered 3,000 new passport books. I was in the hospital for an infection in my leg trying to run the SAAA, and the curve all of a sudden went straight down. So Kevin gave me a call and says, Tom, we'd like to have you join in a new initiative. You might be seeing what's going on with the Biosphere 2 as we have our curators and our docents are actually getting on video and telling people about the Biosphere. And then Reed Park Zoo followed after that, and then the Desert Museum. And next thing you know, Visit Tucson joins in. And we now have a over 1.8 or whatever it is, of unique visitors to their website. So the folks at Visit Tucson, Brent Garrod and Lee created a page for us called Virtual Tucson, okay? And early on, Kevin would corral all of us into a Zoom meeting and tell us about how wonderful it would be to keep your attraction really fresh in the mind, because one day we're gonna open, probably gonna be May. Yeah, we all thought it was going to be May. Then we thought it was going to be October. And luckily, about 55 attractions reopened in the summer. And then we had another surge, and we had to cut back a little bit. But we were able to keep a lot of the attractions open. And there was pent-up demand. And most importantly, because of this gentleman working with Visit Tucson, and asking the SAAA to join in his wonderful vision, many of the attractions now have developed virtual programming and selling it, believe it or not, to teachers who are looking for content because they're just starting to get back to work. So ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to number two recipient who stayed here. Thank you, Kevin. Come on up, Kevin, recipient of the Richard Fidelity Award.
Thank you.
If you notice that everybody at the U of A is smiling except for that guy that isn't here. But we have a lot of fun, don't we, Kevin? And Kevin still works very hard with the Biosphere staff. John and Rick couldn't be with us. They have a special, I think, classroom thing going on this morning, but they send you their love and their thanks and to Kevin. Thank you, Kevin. Okay, so one of the things that we want to talk about right now, and I switched it on you, Wendy, I'm sorry. I do that. The other award that we have is the David J. Nivison Award, and I think in this room right now, Jack Camper was a recipient. I don't remember what year that was, Jack. Do you remember?
Oh, it's been several.
Several years ago. And Rick Vaughn. Rick was a recipient of the David J. Nivison. David J. Nivison was probably the ultimate salesperson for Tucson. He started his career in Old Tucson and moved over to the Biosphere and was at every single trade show that the SAAA sponsored. And he was just the ultimate Tucson salesperson. One day during Christmas time, he just collapsed. And unfortunately, he never woke up after that. So but really our first award that we started giving out was the David J. Nivison Outstanding Excellence in Tourism and Attraction Support. We expanded it to be beyond just the attractions when we began the Richard Fedele Award and moved the David J. Nivison Award to anybody that really helps Tucson in tourism, so they don't have to be necessarily attractions. Some of the winners, and besides Rick and Jack, was the founders. Okay, we all, one year, SAAA gave it to all of the founders, so I'm a proud member of the David J. Nivison Award family. But we've also gave it to Janet Napolitano, when she was the governor, who created a series called Hidden Treasure, which she actually got in a car instead of her plane, and went around the state of Arizona and took a film crew with her and visited many of the attractions. Most of our attractions here in Tucson are small, do probably 25 to 50,000 people. They're totally unique. You don't see them anywhere else. So she visited quite a few of those. It was exciting having Janet Napolitano to our luncheon session at that time at the Arizona Inn. So she was with us, and there's a great picture of all of us that were giving her the award. And I told the story, but I'll tell it one more time. Rich Fedele was on one end, and the other end was me. So we were kind of the bookends of this group of six people with Governor Napolitano in the middle. Well, the press got hold of this, and it was too wide of a shot, so they cut Rich and I out. Needless to say, our PR person was from the U of A, Darlene Lizarraga, so I think I didn't talk to her for at least a day. But it wasn't her fault. But we had great exposure, obviously, with that. So we, our one in 2018 was very special because that was our 20th anniversary. We wanted to give it to someone. If you read some of his economic development plans, he talks about how important the transportation system is and how the economic development normally follows the roads. And over the years, Pima County and RTA and PAG together in partnership have developed a lot of new roads and fixed a lot of roads and is continuing to fix roads over the last 2 years, joining with the city of Tucson and the new bond issue. So Chuck was perfect gentleman to give the 20th anniversary, really, David J. Nivison Award. Well, last year, we gave it to our own Sonny. And, as we all know, we promote Tombstone. We want him to stay here in our hotels and then take a day trip to Tombstone, to Karchner, to Bisbee, and that beautiful area. And but they start in Tombstone. And Tombstone has just been a wonderful partner. One day we'll get the mayor up here, Dusty, and he could really see how we all work together and promote each other. So we're, Sonny has just been, I think I've been on the phone for the last week with Sonny as she was putting together her crew and making sure Wyatt could be here as well. Well, we kind of decided this year to go a little bit out of the state of Arizona, because I have to tell you, this gentleman who started out at Marriott as a senior management helped grow Marriott in the 20 plus years he was there. And then there was a small little company called the Travel Industry of America, or and we wanted to start promoting, you know, the United States. We didn't have a United States tourism office per se, but we had TIA, who did this wonderful trade show. We used to call it Powwow, where every country would come together in one place in the United States, and they would promote tourism. This gentleman became the executive director, president, CEO of U.S. Travel Association when they changed their name. His name is Roger Dow. Roger Dow has been helping every destination marketing organization throughout the United States. He sat next to President Trump every time they started talking about the stimulus. And finally, 501c6s were involved and engaged with the PPP grant program. And if I recall correctly, Mary, a recipient of a very large grant to help us get through these difficult times as we rebuild our tourism market here. So we decided that this year would be a good time to really honor Roger Dow. He's been to our town several times, and so we're very happy to announce that our winner of the 2021 David J. Nivison Award for Outstanding Excellence in Tourism and Traction Support is Roger Dow. Roger is on Facebook Live right now. We got a text with him about 30 minutes ago, and he's deeply honored. He knows Tucson. He knows Brent Durott. He knows a lot of the members of the staff, and he also has been a speaker in another volunteer job that I have with called Skull International USA, which is a tourism group of tourism professionals. And he's often been our webinar leader to share what's going on and how he is helping tourism with the comeback. And he's working extremely hard today. And obviously, we'd love to have had him on an airplane to see us, but he is joining us. So Roger, thank you very much for everything you do. Let's hold up the award so Roger can see it. Don't pick it up by the glass, but just, there you go. Okay, Roger, this is for you, and we'll ship this off to you this week, and thank you very much for all your leadership. Now, there is one more award that we have to share with you. How are we doing on time? Okay, good. We have about 5 minutes. So this particular person has been with us for many years, stepped up when we lost our president, and I think she has probably the title of the longest tenure of the former president, because we've had some people leave to go to U of A, they were presidents, and so this particular lady has been our former president probably at least three times around, I think. And with that comes responsibility. And responsibility means that she talks to me a lot. And she's just full of ideas. And we are really honored to have her still on the board and in charge now of the entire Marana tourism program. So ladies and gentlemen, I want to make sure that you We'll go back. I want to make sure that you have an opportunity to meet Laura Cortell, who are recipients of the Founders Award. Themselves along with all the other attractions. Now, my last awards are special in my heart because, when I retired, I didn't know I was going to continue to do this thing. So I said, well, there's a couple of guys that I really want to honor for all of the years that they've helped me. Well, and that was Jack Camper at Art Eyes. So Jack is with us today. Art is actually doing the audit of Skulls International right now, so I'm glad I wasn't invited to that. But Jack, as you know, over 30 years as the chamber president, I can remember when I walked in after Mr. Huckleberry appointed me the economic development director, and Jack said, what the hell are you doing here? And I said, well, Jack, I'm the new economic development guy. And he goes, did you bring your donuts? That's what we were known for, Pima County. We brought donuts to all the meetings. But clearly, Mr. Huckleberry made a smart move to help me be associated with people like Jack Camper and Art Al. So thank you, Jack. Now, I get to continue this honor and work with people over the years that have continued to help us, continue to help me personally grow here. Again, been in town for about 25 years. And so we would like to honor two folks today with the Extraordinary Mentor Award. And the first gentleman is Rick Vaughn. Rick, come on up.
Okay, right.
I can't say enough about Rick other than he reminds me that I always call him about 5 o'clock, and we always had to tell our wives that it'll be probably an hour before I get home. So, Rick, thank you very much for listening to me. So there's an award over here, Rick.
Oh, sorry. I'm doing the wrong one.
And you also get this compass. So congratulations. All right. Congratulations. You'll get a picture here. Don't go anywhere, okay? The second recipient, I now know that he will always be my plan B. So as I mentioned, Bob and I, got to know each other a little bit several years ago when he was working with Flandrau, and then he was also running this lecture series that he was always insistent that I participate in. And then we got a chance to, when I joined Rotary, that Bob was our president of Rotary. And let me just say, what an exceptional president you were, Bob. Bob took over, created the TARE?
Reign of Terror.
The Reign of Terror. But we all love Bob. He was the president when COVID-19 struck our community, struck the world, and started a virtual Rotary meeting, thanks to Rick Rose, a good friend of ours, that also has done a lot of things for the tourism. And Bob invited me one day to be on his show. And he says, you've done this before, right, Tom? And I go, yeah, but I have a tendency to sway. Yeah, you know? So, and I said, well, I put my arms behind me, and sometimes it stopped. So we get to do take one, and Bob said, I asked Bob, how did I do? And he goes, you were swaying all the hell. Can we reshoot that? So it's really an honor to have Bob as my friend. I'm also serving now on his AV committee at Rotary, and I know that we see each other all the time. He's a great speaker, a great motivator. I remember last time you were in an interview and they said, well, tell me a little bit about your management style. Well, you always like to say I am a coach. This guy was a great coach. And he's taken that knowledge and turned it into millions and millions of dollars for the U of A College of Science. So Bob, come on up here. Thank you very much for your help. Getting close, guys. Okay. All righty. So we are nearing the end of the program, and we got a couple things to do. Wendy's going to talk a little bit, and then we just want to kind of exit with a brief message from Tim Vermerstedt, who's going to talk with about the Desert Thunder, and then we can all send you back to work. So, Wendy.
Okay. Okay, excuse me. First, I would like to introduce you to the members of the 2021 board. So if our members would please stand, and a lot of you are going to be the same ones, Chris, Laura, Hillary, our newest member, Pam Capaconte, and Stan. Thank you. There are members that are not here, and I'm going to try to remember their names. We have Kat Rumbley from the Arizona Sonoran Desert Museum, David Russell from Bisbee. I'm sorry, I can't remember. I'm sorry.
Stan.
I did Stan.
Okay,
you
said Stan.
I said Stan. Did I not say Stan?
Yes.
Okay. So looking forward, again, we're very pleased that we're looking on the upswing and the pandemic will hopefully be behind us. We've done a lot. One of the industries so severely hit was performing arts. And I had a lovely chat with the director of marketing from Arizona Arts, Charlie, and things are looking up for them as well. Everybody has found a way to work outside the box, whether it's been Zoom, Facebook Live, online, however it worked for them to keep things going. And you, as like I said, you should all be so proud of yourselves for what you've been able to accomplish. We are working on some wonderful initiatives that were decided upon in our summer retreat. A few of those would be expanding our selections of attractions, expanding our territory, looking at using the Book of Fun as a fundraising program to charter schools, working with the PTOs and letting the schools sell the Book of Fun to raise funds. It's very similar to what they used to do with the Tucson, with the entertainment book. So we have some new initiatives. I hope everybody is on board and looking forward to a wonderful, wonderful 2021. Even though we have 3 months behind us already, but we're all looking forward. So I would like to bring up Tim Vermerstedt to talk about one of our programs where we're working on with Davis Monthan Air Force Base. Tim?
I'm coming. Not fast. Thank you,
Wendy. Thank you. Good morning, Tim Vermerstedt. I am your Director of Sales and Operations for the Passport. And first of all, I just wanted to say thank you for continuing the David J. Nivison Award. David was a mentor of mine, a dear friend. I actually worked with him at the Biosphere, Old Tucson, back in the 90s. Had the privilege of giving the first David J. Nivison Award back in 2004, when I was your president. So just wanted to say thank you for that. So as Tom mentioned, we've been able to get several previous members back on board, including Pima Airspace, Titan Missile Museum, White Stallion Ranch, Trail to Town. All excited. Hi, Bob.
Sorry about that.
Because he did such a great job, we won't find him $100.
That's true. And Tucson Botanical Gardens also stepped up to the plate. So, as Wendy mentioned, one of the programs we're working with is with Davis Monthan Air Force Base. They approached another organization that I'm a member of, Desert Thunder Squadron. How many of you are familiar with the Automated Commando program? I'm going to ask Michael Gressinger to come up here in a second. But basically, the program is called the Tucson Military Attractions Passport Program. And I'm going to email the final draft to Tom today, and then he can send it out. So I'm not going to go into great detail because I know it'll run a little bit long. Basically, every passport we sell, we'll be donating a passport, a digital passport, to Davis Monthan, just to get spouses off base and get them out to the attractions. The Desert Thunder Squadron is a 501c3, so I'm actually their fundraising chair, so I'll start raising money to maybe cover the other pass. So we're working out the final details of that, but we're going to start off with 100 digital passports that at their discretion, they figure out where the need is and we'll take care of that. So it's a great partnership between Davis Monthan. They're excited. Desert Thunder Squadron is an amazing group. At that point, I'd like to add Mr. Gressinger, would you mind coming up? Can you tell us a little bit about the Desert Thunder Squadron? And thank you for your service, sir.
Thank you. I'll be very brief. Several of the members of Desert Thunder are here today. Pam Traficante just left. Bob, of course, who's a member of everything, is on our board. Our former commander, Alan Jimenez, is back there in the back. And did I miss anybody? Seemed like there was somebody. And Tim, of course. Davis Monthan has an honorary commander program where people from the community are selected to serve a 2-year term with various squadrons and divisions on base. And as a result of the 2-year limit, they are all mostly, I should say, very reluctant to leave, and they would like to stay connected with Davis Monthan. So for one of the former base commanders, James Meeker, set up the program that Ellen and I kind of put together. And we now have all of the former honorary commanders as part of the Desert Thunder Squadron. And if they become active in that squadron, they will then continue to be able to have access to base, be invited to different programs that the squadrons that they were honorary for are having. And one of the two things that Desert Thunder does are assist with the honorary commander program, and second is to support the airmen on the base. We're not an advocacy group, we're strictly a community relations group with the airmen. And the spouse resilience program that has been put together by one of the spouses, actually, is a thing that we're going to be supporting the most. And that the idea is that spouses are often under some stress, either because of a move or a change of station. Their spouse has been deployed to a not so fun place. And just the idea of getting that more of the community and airmen kind of mix for support. Because actually the members of the military contribute a lot to different philanthropic things in Tucson, as well as enjoying the activities and attractions. So that's kind of what we're about. We're looking forward to this. We think this program will go national. It's got a lot of potential, and thank you very much for letting us join you in this.
Before we go, Mike, we wanted to honor you with the certificate, the Desert Thunder Squadron, our 2021 honorary member. So thank you very much. We're very happy to work with you.
Good. Thank you.
One more.
Oh, okay. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, guys, we're getting pretty close here. So I'm just going to kind of really read off these members really fast, if that's okay, Wendy. I just wanted to give you an idea, really, that this organization continues to be very viable. If you're here still, just come on up and we'll give you your certificate, Wendy, if you could help me. So our first new member is Midlife Single. It's a new tour company here in town. So come on up. The City of Tombstone, will you, Sonny, come on up and get this certificate? There you go. Marshall Wyatt Earp. We are honoring you with an honorary member, so if you would come up. Okay. Dan. From the Southeast Arizona Hispanic Chamber. Glad to have the Tucson Hispanic Chamber back again. Okay. All right, so.
Let me also present on behalf of Isabel Jones, the proud member plaque, and we have a reciprocal membership. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great. Oh, here, this is an extra. Hey, Dan, make sure you give this to Isabel. Okay, alrighty, so we're almost there, guys. Alrighty, let's see. So proud to have these new. The Southern Arizona Arts Guild, she's still here, or did she have to go back? Oh, come on over, come on up, Teresa. Thank you, definitely one of our newest members. Jason, you still here?
Yep.
Your new name change, Local IQ. Thank you for staying with us. There you go.
Thanks, sir.
And we certainly would like to honor the U Arizona, which is the new branding, Arizona Arts. Come on up, sir, and we have your new membership certificate. All right. Rick, still here. Edited Marketing, Ed and Rick. Wonderful partners of ours. So we have a membership certificate for you. And let's see, our new and one of our newest members hasn't been officially voted in, but we know somebody here. Tell me when. The Vicar St. Paul's Episcopal Church, Vicar, I'm sorry. St. Paul's, come on up, Sonny, that's yours too. Glad to have them as well. So listen, we're off to a great start in 2021. I didn't count how many new members we had there, but we really appreciate all of you, and I'm going to turn it back over to Wendy to close out the meeting.
Awesome. Thank you so much to the Hispanic Chamber. Look forward to working with you. Closing remarks. I'm looking forward to a wonderful year going forward. I look forward to seeing more attractions than I've been able to see in this past year. And wow, just great that we have so many new members and members that are signing up. And the digital platform is actually improving. So we're looking forward to a much more vigorous sales and our digital programming. So, you know, everybody just keep your eyes to the sky and just keep moving forward. You know, sometimes it's gonna be two steps forward, one step back, but we're still moving forward. I thank you all for joining us. I hope you had a wonderful breakfast. Thank you so much to the Hacienda del Sol for hosting this, and enjoy the rest of your day. And again, thank you for coming.